Okay, so let's start. This talk will be about the Android part of LibreOffice, and even if the focus of this talk will be about the core application like the viewer or this basic editor, there is also this LibreOffice Impress remote. I'm controlling the presentation from this phone. And let's experiment with this. If it will crash by the end of the presentation, I will have to go here and press some keys, or it will actually work, even if it's kind of a lag demo. So let's see what has been done up to today. The very first step for the in the history of the Android port was to get this huge code-based cross-compile that was mostly done back in the SUSE times, where Tor did spend quite some time on getting this to work. And one of the major problems was that Android is not Linux, like it's the same kernel, but everything else is something custom with stupid limitations. And if this reminds you of Windows, then you are not alone. So the linker has this stupid limitation of 128 shared libraries, and we have much more. So we have to link all this code to a single shared library. And because we are cross-compiling, we can't run any unit tasks, and we have we had to. Or he had to solve a number of problems till something was built. There was a document loader prototype. It was using the Uno Java binding, because initially the idea was that if Uno already is a Java binding and Android prefers Java, then it might be a good idea to retarget that for this purpose. It didn't really work out. It looked like this, so you could switch between the pages and have the document rendered at a fixed size. I guess you couldn't really zoom into it, or maybe there was some support for that, but it was quite limited in many ways. The purpose was just to be able to exercise the actual rendering. The rendering, it was, the result was quite how the printing result looked like. So it wasn't something that could be later extended to be an editor as well. But it was a start. Another prototype next to this was, or another approach, would be that the desktop rendering would be completely reused, and basically be rendered into background bitmap, and whenever the bitmap was changed, then we copied that to the Android screen. So it looked like this. You can notice the desktop menus, and basically really the whole desktop was copied. The reason why we could do this was because, at least on Linux, there is no desktop integration available. We fall back to this ROX 11 backend, and that really had no external dependency. So that could be, it really wanted to paint all the pixels itself, so it could be something that could be repurposed for the Android rendering as well. So we had this document loader prototype. It could load a document that was hard coded by real time, basically. So it was far from something that could be useful for an end user. So that was a GSAC project which tried to build on top of this document loader, and and try to add this document browser. Actually, this is the oldest part that's still part of the current Android viewer. You could say that it's some duplication because why try to be a file manager when we are building a document view or a document editor. But again, one more Android stupidity is that it doesn't come with a file manager on most of the phones. So you have to provide some way for the user to choose a file. And even if you have a file manager, Android has some interesting idea about how to determine what application to use with a given file. Like it doesn't do any kind of deep file detection what we do on the LibreOffice side, but it just does it based on the file extension, and it has a huge hash map about what the file extension belongs to what my type. And for example, the impress template type is missing from the hash map. So if you would like to open impress templates, then you still need this document browser because we know that it's an impress template that Android doesn't know. So it looks like this. There was some minor updates to this in the current version, but it's really similar. This part was basically unchanged. What was extended here later is that now you can also open remote files. Igalia did some work on this so that you can load documents from on cloud, you can save to down, and there is an interface between the on cloud code and the document viewer, so you can add multiple backends and so on. So the next big thing towards this current state where we have a viewer and we do have additionally a basic editor is tag rendering. That's the core of the viewer that we have today. And by tiles, we mean these small bitmaps. And we render into these small bitmaps so that when something changes, you don't have to re-render the whole screen, just the chain bitmap. The idea is from Mozilla. They invented this for Firefox. And I guess by today, mostly they use it everywhere. Maybe not on Linux, but I think on Windows and Mac, they use it even in the desktop version. So in one of the earlier talks, it was mentioned that in the long term, it would be nice if LibreOffice would do this on the desktop. It might sound like a pipe dream, but actually Mozilla did this and it seems that it works, so it's not a completely unfounded idea. So the big thing with this tag rendering is that you have to implement it in the given applications. Initially, it was for Writer. I think Candy prototyped it, and then later, or Candy and Tor did work around it. Actually, we had a working tag renderer for Writer, but not for Calc and Impress. And there was a follow-up GStack project so that the Impress tile rendering got implemented. And also there was some attempt to do it for Calc, but it was done on a feature branch, and as far as I know, it didn't do good things for the Calc desktop rendering, so that never landed on Mastodon. A bit later, Kohai and Henry did most of the work around that, so that we can have something that's tied rendering for Calc and still not breaking the desktop rendering. So this is how it looked like in this GTK tile viewer. It's a testbed application. It's built by default. It's not part of the installation set, so you have to run this with this bin/run shell script. But you can test all the C++ parts of this tile rendering and later tile editing features. So at the end, you will see how the editing part looks like. And I did most of the work on the LibreOffice side, and Tomasz Feingard did most of the Java part. So actually, I most of the time I didn't have the Android. I just made things work from this type viewer. And once it was working, then Thomas took over and actually did the real work. That's a great way to avoid touching Android when you are supposed to do Android work. Tomasz integrated the existing Tide renderer with the FANUC frontend from Mozilla that's used for Firefox for Android. So we have the C++ core, we are using the whole libreoffice. On the other hand, the output is just the ties and some API between the C++ core and the Java application. And what you see as a user is some native user interface that's written completely in Java, and it's completely separated from the desktop user interface. That's quite a big contrast to the desktop prototype where we reused everything. It sounds like this is more the way to go. So this is the first screenshot from this FANUC-based viewer that already used the Tide rendering. You will see later that something that there is an additional toolbar and a few changes, but it's basically like this. A major step towards the end users was when this was pushed to the Google Play Store. That means that we had to fulfill all the requirements, even if it's well known that the Play Store rules are much more liberal compared to the Apple App Store requirements. We still have this problem with the size limit. The rule from Google is that the APKs, so the compressed application, can be more than 50 megabytes. And that's still a problem today. If you search from LibreOffice in the Play Store, then you will find two versions. One is the collaborative version. That's still a viewer. It doesn't have the editing capabilities. On the other hand, it can open a few more files, most notably all the Microsoft formats. And there is another flavor, just playing games with adding or removing different services, so that you can choose what features will be included, and you are still not above this size limit. So the version from TDF has these basic editing capabilities. On the other hand, it can only open ODF files. So this is something to be solved, so that if you build yourself and you just push the APK to your Android device, then you can have both at the same time. So once we had something in the Play Store for the VR, the next big step, of course, was the editing. And this is what was sponsored by the TDF. And this is something that's news since, for example, FOSDEM, when there was also a session about the Android port. What we had by the time of this year's FOSDEM was basically the viewer, and in case the document had blinking text, then the rendering result on Android also was blinking. So we had some kind of working invalidation handler, but that was on. So the first problem we had to solve was that we said that we have a working viewer, but the clock was still lagging behind. The root of this problem was that while the writer works in logical units in TWIPS, and while Impress works also in logical units in 100 millimeters, clock is switching between these units, even uses pixels sometimes, and for the Tide rendering purpose, we are always working in TWIP, so we are always working in logical units, and in case some part of the rendering result would like to work in pixel, then we have a problem. Related comment is that in writer, the writer comments are again pixel-based, and that's why currently they are missing from the tight rendering result because some additional work would be needed there. Again, if it would be all in Logica units, then that would be much easier. But with time, we got something that's usable enough, and we could claim that the type rendering in calc is good enough so that we can go to the editing part. There was a session from our talk from by Candy as part of the GSOC panel, demonstrating what Christian Peter did with Sunlord to improve the calc situation further. So there is hope that one day the calc will be as clean as writer and impress from this logical unit rendering perspective. So tight editing, that's the next big thing. The major thing is that when we had only a viewer, then we rendered something once, and we could assume that it never changes. If we were out of memory or something, then we could drop tiles and then re-render them later. But apart from that, once we got a tile, we could keep it as long as we wanted. This is no longer the case with editing. While before it was possible that the Java user interface just plugged into the C++ core and requested the tiles as it wanted, we had to implement the direction, the communication in the other direction as well, so that there is no callback at a LibreOffice kit level, and that it can signal if something happens, like you are supposed to drop tiles intersecting with a given logic or rectangle and stuff like this. The good thing is that the FANAC code base that we imported from Firefox is prepared for this, because even if you use the web browser most of the time as a viewer, as an HTML viewer, there is this crazy JavaScript thing that allows you to modify the document contents, so they have to re-render things left and right already. So it's something that we can reuse for our editing needs as well. See, I already mentioned the GTK type viewer. It allows a bit more productive development from two perspectives. One is that even if you have debug symbols, then linking this separate shared object isn't that much time, and GTK type viewer can use these updated shared objects, so the hack, compile, or test iteration can be relatively fast. On the other hand, if you would like to do the same on Android, then either you don't have the debug symbols, but still then it takes around 1 minute to do one of these cycles, or you have debug symbols and you hit some limitations in the linker, which means that a full debug UTL linking for Android takes around, if you have enough memory, so it actually finishes, it takes more than 10 minutes or something like this. So that's not far from ideal. What is really strange is that the same situation on for iOS isn't that bad. So they do have a linker that can cope with the fully built debug UTL large object files and linking them together to a single shared object or single executable in a reasonable time. So let's hope with time the toolchain will actually catch up with our requirements. What we need for an editor, we need some input handling from the soft keyboard and touchy ones. We need some cursor, we need selections, we need invalidation, and then we will have something that allows basic editing from an end user perspective. So as mentioned, this is sponsored by the TTF, and the good thing about this is that basically none of the companies or clients had enough budget to get this going. So it was realized that it's necessary to put out a tender that allows somebody to do all the grounding work to get this going, and that actually happened. So we won this part, and we could dedicate a couple of months to implement this. So the first thing was this blinking tax. It's a nice use case where the rendering result has to be updated, but you don't have to have working input handling. So you don't have to solve two problems at the same time, which is exactly what you want when you have to work on this. And this is basically where the presentation at Fosdam was finished. So what are the new things done? LibreOffice has the keyboard and mouse handling. We mapped the Android soft keyboard to the keyboard handling of LibreOffice, and we mapped the touch events from Android to mouse events. Interestingly, since then, there was also some work in parallel with this from the GTK3 part. Or the GTK3 buttons, where the touch events are propagated to VCR as real touch events. We wanted to reuse as much as possible, so all the Android touch events are mapped to the mouse events. That's how we got a number of things for free, like if we map, for example, long press to double click, then long pressing on a board will automatically do this handling, so that double click on a board creates a selection on the board and features like this. If later the VCR attach support will be good enough, it could be a possibility to remap the Android touch events to VCR attach events. The next thing was some native overlay. We wanted to have the cursor and the selections not as part of the rendering result in the tiles, so that if you just navigate with the cursor or you change the selection, then we don't have to re-render. If you ever looked into this, even on the desktop we have overlays for this. So all we had to do was to disable these native overlays, from a LibreOffice perspective, native for the tile rendering, so that we can add these overlays from Java on the native Android UI. So by native, I mean the Java native. We have the cursor. When it changes, then the LibreOffice Kit callback informs the Java layer where the new cursor rectangle is, and also the same for the selection rectangles. The cursor is easy, it's really just a rectangle, but the selection can be more complicated. It's basically a list of rectangles, and also in the mobile world it's common that you have selection handles, so that you can adjust both the start and the end of the selection. This is something we implemented. This is something that LibreOffice Core didn't support. So if on the desktop you create a selection and you are still holding down the mouse button, then you can adjust the end of the selection, but not the start of it. This is something that we had to implement. On the other hand, for the where is the selection and where is the cursor, that's something that the desktop version already knew, and we had to just instrument this code with the necessary LibreOffice Kit callback, so that this information is available for the Java layer. This is the first demo. This is showing what's possible in a writer. So default you get this viewer, and then if you tap on it, then you get an editor. You can tap as far, and then the cursor is moved. you can type something and then the letters, even accented ones, the random Unicode values are supported. Of course, if you are in the middle of a bullet list and a new press enter, then the cursor jumps. You can adjust the selection, both the start and the end. You can also drag the cursor. I hope it will be part of one of these demo videos. If you had something selected and you type something, then of course it will be overwritten. If you have some selection inside the table for a word, then you can adjust the selection handles and it will, the word selection will turn into a table selection. That's quite handy with this limited mobile input capabilities. If you long press on a table side, then it will also create a table selection. You can tap on an image, and it's possible to move around and resize them. In Writer, the shape text is provided by the edit engine. That's something completely different. You can also edit that. You can again resize the shapes as well. If you notice, the images are resized, keeping their aspect ratio as it happens on the desktop. If you resize shapes, then this won't happen because that's what users are used to when they use the desktop version. You can create a selection and then use one of these buttons on the, in the toolbar to dispatch Unicode commands on it, so you can mark it as bold or italic or stretch through or what you prefer. It's really just up to adding more buttons to the toolbar, or it's kind of an area of more for somebody who is more into the user experience part to decide exactly what buttons to put there. It's similar to the toolbars on the desktop version, when we just have an API for this Uno commands, and then it's up to some XML files to define exactly how these toolbars are organized and what buttons in what order appear and so on. So it's again, it's similar here, it's quite configurable. So this is for Writer, but once we had something working for Writer, we wanted to make sure that it won't happen that Impress and Calc can't catch up. We had this problem with the viewer, that the Calc part was lagging behind. I'm not exactly sure where we were with the Writer one, but we weren't ready with this. We Writer at this level, then we also switched to Impress and Calc and brought up it up to be on par with Writer, and switched back to Writer, and did something new again there, and it was like this. So this is for Writer. The next thing was Impress. For the core part, again, that was mostly my fault to do the necessary instrumentation so that the Java layer is aware of what's happening on the core side. Again, this is now this edit engine text. You have the blinking cursor. You can track the cursor to some other position and the cursor will be adjusted. The cursor is not moved to some random place, but we just send the information where it was dragged, and then core will decide what's the valid cursor position, that's the nearest point where it could be placed. And basically we added the same features to Impress as well, so if you have a bullet list, then you can add a new one, you can create a selection. If you notice this this small bubble on the video, that's presenting where I was with my finger, so you can see how something is started and dragged away and so on. Other than that, it's similar. So again, we support this, and that you select a word and type something and it gets overwritten just as you would expect from the desktop version. Something that required a bit more work was this Impress tables, because again, that's completely different code from the Writer tables. This is mostly in S3 acts. and we wanted to have the same behavior. As you could see, you can switch between the slides and as you call them, document parts, so that can be a slide or a cut sheet, and you can click inside the shape text that there or something, you can resize the shapes. What's implemented should be really close to the desktop version, except when there was already some common behavior that that was quite standard in the mobile world, and we wanted to be consistent with that. So the last video will be about CAG, and this is. I'm pressing the wrong button, so it goes backwards. So the last demo video is about CAG. We had a single larger sheet. So in the video, you will also see how you can pan around with the document. You can also zoom in case the text is too small, so that you could position the cursor precisely. If you notice here, the selection is a bit off from the text. Even the cursor has this annoying 1 pixel differences. Maybe it's even a bit more. That's because of these annoying inconsistencies in the CAG rendering and switching between the logical units and pixels. And then these rounding errors or off by one errors can add up. The hope is that this will improve as the CAG rendering moves more and more to use logical units in the rendering. But other than that, it's really the same. One challenge we had to solve that when you load the document and just render it, then the image is not yet there, because if we know where to paint the text, then we already showed that, and the image is loaded later, it's a bit more expensive operation, and then we had some problem with the invalidation, so that we wanted to show the document without the image, then load the image, and when the image was loaded, invalidate the necessary tiles so that you can actually see them. But other than that, you can see it, even for CAG, the same user features. So that's where we are. Do I still have some time?
I guess it was nice.
Okay, so I promise I won't use all the time from Thorsten's slot, even if he's not here. What's still not done, but would be really easy to do on the Android user interface layer, is the features where we did something. We did some API at the LibreOffice Suite level for LibreOffice Online. But the Android user interface didn't hold up. So one trivial thing would be to find out what services are exactly necessary to support flat ODF, and then those documents could be loaded as well. Because of the size limitations, by default, all UNO services are excluded, and you have to explicitly whitelist or the UNO components or UNO constructors necessary to be included in the product or the APK. So the next idea would be support for searching. The LibreOffice Suite API is there. Just the GNI and the Java part would be necessary to implement. One more nice feature would be that once you have a selection, you could copy it to the Android Kit clipboard. Again, the lock API is done. One more thing to fix, and it would not be too hard to implement, to have some proper feedback about saving. Currently, we just dispatch this UNO command so that the save will be initiated, and sooner or later it will end. But it's asynchronous, and we don't know when exactly it finished. It would be better to handle it explicitly, like we do it for the opening of the document. We know exactly when it finished. We could even have some kind of progress bar for it, and we know if it succeeded or failed. It's quite misleading that currently there is no feedback about the saving result, so that even if it failed, you don't see anything. You just close the document, open it again, and if it failed, you see the old version. So I guess that's it. Thanks for everyone from my colleagues who have. Most of the work was done by Tomáš and me, but as you can see, a number of other people have. Also the sponsors, so back down Suza, then Smooth was the company who funded all the work around the viewer, and TDF sponsored the basic editing part. And really, without these sponsors, we as Collabor, as a consulting company, couldn't do this, because we have to work on something that's paid by something. So that's how this became possible. So thanks for listening. The impression didn't crash. So if you have any questions, I may try to answer it. Yes?
Is there any particular minimum system requirements for an Android?
Yes, the question was if there are any minimum system requirements. Yes, there are different API levels that the application can declare, and I guess we require Android for that. Tomáš, are you here?
Yeah.
Is that correct? You require for that, right?
401.
I'm afraid it's quite possible this is not developed anywhere. But if you install from the Play Store, then the Play Store will prevent you from installing it on another device. Most of these UI elements are something that's not available as is in earlier versions. But hopefully 4.0 is not a huge requirement nowadays. Anything else? Any other questions? 1, 2, 3. Okay, thanks for your attention.